everybody, welcome into the show tonight. I'm Brian Keating alongside Carson Cunningham. You ready?
Let's crash the boards.
Let's crash the boards because, I mean, what an eventful day here in the state of Oklahoma. We had NCAA tournament selection bubbles burst, and then for the Oklahoma Sooners, they're into the NCAA tournament. So I want to start right there. We'll get into both of them. But OU into the tournament, 10 seed, playing Rhode Island. Sooners, you know, they were a hot topic around the country. How do they get in and not OSU? What do you think about Oklahoma getting in?
Well, this time a few months ago, we didn't think the Sooners would be sweating.
That's they were
exactly
doing all
what
of
they're
that.
Doing. I need to get a different color.
It's hard to see. Okay.
Sooners get... sweating. I mean, Brian, I don't think there's any way you can justify that them being in this tournament. I think people cling on to this non-conference schedule they had. It's really no different than OSU's, really. They have a few more wins in the non-conference. But they lost 11 of their last 15 games. They won two road games all season long. Really one true road game, if you want to lump in Wichita State.
Yep.
We'll give them two. Good teams win on the road. Oklahoma's not a good basketball team, Brian. They've lost their last five games by an average of 21 points. You can't convince me they're one of the best teams in the country, let alone deserve to play in the NCAA tournament. Look, I know Trae Young is one of the best players in the country, but OU played their way out, and there's teams with far better resumes, even Oklahoma State we'll talk about in a second. I think this is a joke they're in the tournament.
Well, I think they're very fortunate to be in the tournament because I would not have put them in. I don't think they're playing at an NCAA tournament level. But I do want to say this. They did start 14-2, and I think you do have to give them credit for the way they started, beat Wichita State, beat USC, and then West Virginia Tech, TCU, all in that 14-2 start. They have played very poorly of late. There's no doubt about that. But, I mean, they're fortunate to be in. Their resume is not great, but they were solidly in by the committee to be a 10 seed. I thought maybe they were in the play-in game. Maybe the Trae Young effect made a difference in this. You know, when you look at all these bubble teams that are so close, maybe the fact that Oklahoma has Trae Young and more people might want to watch Trae Young play basketball than some other bubble team, maybe that gets him in. It didn't hurt Oklahoma, but they're going.
He is must-see TV.
Yeah.
That's why that definitely helped OU's
cause. You give
him
a chance to win?
Yeah, of course I do. Rhode Island's a good team, but they're from the A-10. I mean, if Trae Young gets hot, oh, you can play with anybody. We've seen that throughout the year. As you mentioned earlier in the season, he played pretty well.
And they haven't seen Trae Young yet. So I think that, you know, Big 12 teams figured out ways to defend him. Rhode Island's not going to know how to
and
do
OU
that.
And OU was great on a neutral floor without Big 12 officiating where it gets a little more rough and physical. So that could help Trae Young as well.
OSU's out. You okay with that?
I tell you, I didn't think I would see anything that makes college football seem sane.
That's
really what college basketball is doing to me now. I think it's funny, too. OSU killed the BCS back in 2011 with their football team. They might kill the RPI because it's crazy to me when we're talking about OSU. We're not talking about their wins. We're talking about their non-conference schedule lowered their RPI. Yeah. When Pepperdine wasn't good. Who cares about Pepperdine and those nonsense teams everyone schedules? They beat more quality teams than almost anybody in the country. That includes teams in the field. OSU played, and this notion OSU didn't play anybody. They played 17 teams in the quadrant one. That's second most in the entire country. Get out of here with they didn't play anybody. They beat eight tournament teams. You know how many OU beat? OU's great schedule they played so early.
How many?
Six. OSU has two more wins against teams in the tournament. I mean, OSU has the wins to get in. That's the biggest problem I have with this. We're not talking about who they beat. We're talking about a scheduling quirk that they made 2 years ago and teams that really don't have any relevance at all in the NCAA tournament.
OSU lost 14 games. I like their resume. I would have put them in over Oklahoma. I think they're better than Oklahoma. They beat them twice. I think they had better quality wins. But, you know, there's a video going around, and Dick Vitale called it a disgrace. It's not a disgrace. OSU is a 14-loss team. I know they tied for sixth, but they also were the 8th seed in a 10-team tournament. So, yes, while I think they have the resume, and I would have put them in, it's not a disgrace that they're not in. I mean, they had plenty of opportunities to play themselves into that tournament. If they get to 20 wins, they're probably in.
Yeah.
And that still gives them 13 losses. So it's not a disgrace. Like, they're good enough to be in that tournament. But, I mean, at some point you draw the line, how many Big 12 teams are you going to put in? They put seven. Yeah. So OSU had opportunities to play themselves in and didn't.
Well, they're going to rue some of those home games in the Big 12. They're going to rue the game at Arkansas. But
right.
I think when you compare them to, like, Syracuse didn't beat anybody with a pulse.
When you
How
look
did
at,
they get in over
when
OSU?
When you look at their contemporaries, I think their resume is better.
Yeah,
I think that's
true.
I
hate to make it an OU and OSU thing. There's plenty of teams that OU and OSU both deserve to get in ahead of.
You good now?
I'm good. This RPI, this non-conference schedule nonsense just drives. OSU scheduled people. You put it out. They scheduled Wichita State, Arkansas, A&M. I mean, it doesn't matter.
Let's talk about the Thunder. OKC big win over San Antonio. You know, maybe playing a little bit better.
Yeah, they are. I mean, do you believe they've won 9 of 14? Doesn't feel like it, right?
It does not feel like they've won 9 of 14.
I looked it up and everything.
Wow.
The biggest difference lately, Brian, is the defense is not resting.
Oh.
Obviously, we've talked all, you know, year really since Andre's been out about their defense. You know, the last two wins, they haven't allowed 100 points.
87 and 94.
Last
time they did that? Because my word was defense.
Okay, yeah.
So we're right on par.
February 11th was the last time they didn't, you know, the last time they held somebody below 100 before the last two wins. And I think the big difference here was Russell Westbrook.
Yep.
We've talked about it after the show last night. When he is distributing and not shooting threes, their offense is so much better. And I thought it was an impressive win. They lose Steven Adams, their defensive anchor, and still play good defense. That's a good sign.
You mentioned Russell Westbrook. He's taken 1 3-point shot in the last two games. Two blowout wins, by the way, by OKC.
Just one?
One.
Wow.
He's shot 18 free throws in that same period. It means he's attacking the basket, means he's getting to the free throw line. He's not making it the clip that you expect Russ to make them, but it's getting other guys to the free throw line. It's setting everybody up, and it's better possessions for OKC. It gives them a better chance to win. So Russell's playing better. They're playing better defense and winning some games.
Yeah, even though Carmelo and Paul George aren't playing that well either, they're still able to win. And tough stretch coming, or like 3-game stretch, they should win coming up.